I have heard from Jen and Molly that they will be absent today. I have not heard from Todd. I think he will show up. If he doesn't show up, then I think that that has implications for our voting on officers, because it means that there's only four of us. If there's a tie, there's no way to split it. Do people feel strongly about voting on officers today, or is that something we could table if we're, there's only four of us?
Or you can nominate your favorite commissioner that's not here.
I would be happy for anyone to be officers, frankly. I think we're such a great group. Okay, well, in that case, I am going to, in Todd's absence, unless he shows up soon, I am going to table that agenda item, which is the voting of officers. Okie dokie. So we all have the latest minutes in front of us, is that right?
No, we're still one behind.
You're still one behind, okay.
Sorry.
All right, so if anyone, everyone can read the minutes of February 15th. Page 3 under Lily Lombard, way too tight of a tight line. It's just T-O. Do we have a second?
I wasn't here, so I can't.
Okay. Rob, we're waiting for a second. Oh, you're still working on it?
Yeah. Okay, second.
Okay, all in favor? All right. Minutes have been approved from February 15th. Okay, no public comment. Chair report. Okay. From last meeting, we had talked about potentially during the next couple of months, while I can't make every meeting, switching to once a month. Rich was not in favor of that because of he feels that there's some urgent things this spring, Arbor Day planning, spring planting and so forth, that are really need us to be on top of. So that's fine. I have no problem with that. And so on those meetings that I'll be absent, Todd will be the chair. Mm-hmm. Okay, so that's that.
What meetings are those? Do you know?
I don't know offhand. Okay. It's probably going to be two.
Okay.
All right. I reached out to the director of the Downtown Northampton Association to talk about downtown plantings, and she is going to, her name is Amy, I don't know what her last name is off the top of my head. She's going to visit our meeting on April 5th, and I will try to make that one. So that's our next meeting. I have a few more items. One is that I had a meeting with Molly Freilicher, which I'll discuss in a little more detail when we talk about planting priorities. But I mentioned some of the things that we, that have come out of our tree inventory and Davey's suggested management plan, and how Molly Hale recommended that we get in front of potential pest outbreaks. And so she is forwarded me a template for managing pests and getting in front of that. And I asked Molly Hale if she could review that template and give us a summary, and she said yes, she'd be happy to. So she'll be presenting that at a future meeting. Andrew Smith also reached out to Rich and me with just a link to the latest bill that's been submitted for updating Mass General Law 87. This is a recirculation of an amendment that has just failed to get out of committee every legislative cycle. And so I reached out to Molly Freilicher again, and she said that this is something that the Tree Wardens Association usually tries to, you know, take up and push, but it is going to require some, you know, some lobbying, citizen lobbying, for it to move anywhere. So I wanted to know if somebody, if I sent them the link to the amendment, if they would be willing to look at it, summarize it for us, and bring back a summary so that we could consider whether we want to write a group letter, you know, encourage Northampton citizens to reach out to their elected officials, what have you. But I just thought that it has a significant impact on the work we do. It is the major law that underpins our Rich's existence and the protection of public shade trees. So I feel like it's worthwhile to study this piece of legislation that could greatly clarify. The Mass General Law 87 is so, as you know, unclear about about so many things.
And it's written in 1903. It hasn't been updated since.
Yeah. So it really needs it needs to be updated. So would
I'd
anyone?
I'd be glad to look at that.
Okay. Great. Can you maybe come back? How much time do you need before you can come back and give us a little summary on it?
Probably the next meeting.
Okay. We'll put that on your to-do list. Thank you.
You're going to send me a...
I'll send you a link.
Okay.
Yep. Okay. Okay. I really regret to inform everybody that the meeting that we had scheduled with the mayor last Monday, I failed to attend. It was one of those deeply embarrassing moments in life, and it just happened. Luckily, people were forgiving of my complete snafu, and we are rescheduling with the mayor. So, to be continued. The last thing on my chair report is that I am meeting, and Rich, this might be interesting to you too, at the request of an East Hampton citizen who is also kind of a fellow climate activist. I was at a recent climate-related meeting in which I mentioned the importance of public shade trees as a tool for mitigating and this is all treating, I guess, climate change, managing climate change. And so she followed up with a request that I meet with her and East Hampton's city planner to discuss East Hampton's tree plan program, which is pretty much non-existent. I've actually, through informal channels, met with the East Hampton city planner in the past, And so I heard this straight from her, that, you know, they just don't have a vibrancy program. So she asked if I'd be willing to sit down with her and the city planner and talk about what we've done and how they could potentially move in that direction. So we're going to do that. I invited Molly Freilicher to the meeting because, you know, she is the best person to provide information about what the state can offer to support municipal tree programs. So that's happening in like 10 days. And Rich, if this is something that you might be interested in coming to?
What's the date?
It's the 20th, I want to say. Hold on. I'm having a little trouble with my computer at the moment, so.
The 20th of April or the 20th of March?
I'll tell you in a second. It's next Monday, March 20th.
What time?
10 o'clock.
In East Hampton?
Yep.
A municipal office somewhere?
Yeah, it's, the address is 50 Payson Avenue, P-A-Y-S-O-N.
Who is sponsoring this?
I forget the name of this East Hampton city planner, but that's her office. It is a female. She's probably been there for 3 or 4 years. Not a long, more like 5 maybe. Not a long time. But I think she'll be sympathetic. I think she'll be interested and sympathetic. And
it's not so much about being sympathetic. It's just my own experiences that I guess I would look at it from my perspective. If I was in someone's shoes, and I don't know who manages the trees over there, but you have the tree warden from Northampton coming to East Hampton to communicate with someone. I wasn't pushing by the fight.
Yeah, yeah. Well, how about a fight? Do you want me to try to make those connections this week?
Yeah.
Okay.
If you could do that, I would feel more comfortable.
That makes sense. Sure.
It was some type of an official invite. I'm not saying
that
your invitation is not official, but it's like sort of like turf.
Yeah.
Not turf.
And course, I don't think that they have a hired tree warden. I think that they have a volunteer tree warden. I could be wrong about that, but
he works for the Parks Department, I think.
Okay.
All right. So
it's a part-time job. Yeah.
It's a part, but it is a paid job.
I don't think he gets paid much.
Okay. Well, you know what? It sounds like I've got a little bit of homework to do, and I'll make sure I do that before Monday.
All right.
Okay.
That time works for me, so it's
okay. And then, you know, when I mentioned this to Molly, who will be there, she just, and I also mentioned that Hadley was creating a tree warden, a tree commission, and she, you know, she just thought that we might want to start thinking a little bit more regionally. In terms of, you know, there are grants that are more available when you're for regional tree planting. And so we might just try to zoom out a little bit and see if there's any ways, you know, I don't know, for example, like bulk purchasing, Molly even mentioned something like hiring a consultant to help us think regionally. Like, we don't necessarily have to answer these questions ourselves, but somebody who's got expertise might be able to. So, she said that there's state money specifically for that sort of thing. All right, I think I'm done with my tree report.
Okay.
Do you know of any communities that are doing regional efforts, Lily?
No. Do you, Jay?
No. Molly would be the one to know.
Yeah.
It's either, it seems to me, it's either you have a tree warden or you, with a tree commission or tree committee of some sort, or there's municipalities that just have part-time tree wardens, some are volunteers, some are paid, and there's no, very little public input. It's sort of like the sealer of measuring weights in Northampton that we have, which is the person who mysteriously goes around and makes sure that you're getting the right amount of
John Fry.
Yeah, the gasoline or the amount of fuel you get out of your gas pumps, you know, it's kind of funny. But it would be interesting. it would be interesting to see what kind of regional, you know, to band together as a group. You know, the Western Mass tree wardens, which is funny because I don't think in any of those meetings I've ever met anyone from East Hampton. Whoever that.
I just know from when I worked over there.
Yeah, I don't, is it a city employee who is the?
Yeah.
Yeah, I've never met the person and I don't believe that they've ever been at any of the Western Mass.
Okay.
I don't think I've ever seen them.
Yeah.
I'm not sure they're still doing it, actually.
Okay, okay. That's it for my tree report, or chair report.
So just a couple of things. We have a public shade tree hearing scheduled on March 22nd at 5 p.m. in the afternoon at 137 Parkville Road.
We don't have the one in here?
Yes.
Is it a healthy tree? Well.
They're both healthy. Yep, there's nothing wrong with them. The woman who's petitioned for the public shade tree hearing requests the trees be removed to reestablish her view of Montana.
Oh, okay.
It's a distance.
All right. So this is somewhat a foregone conclusion for you.
Well, it's a foregone conclusion for me, but it would be nice to have other folks there as well. You know, I'm going to deny her based on the fact that that's not our policy. We just don't cut trees down for the sake of providing the business.
Yeah.
So.
What's the time of that again?
It's at 5 p.m.
What date?
The 22nd. Next, it's a week from today.
I can't be there, unfortunately. And what's the address?
137 Parkville Road.
Okay. Yeah, they have quite nice vistas on that road.
Some of the homes do.
It's one of the prettiest vistas.
The trees, in my opinion, are not from the ground. They don't, I mean, they're large, but they're not. Her house is so high up, I just can't imagine that she can't see.
Yeah.
Maybe I'm mistaken, I don't live there, so. But she, you know, requested a public shade tree.
Curious, do you know anything about the trees, like the diameter? I mean, because if I could churn them into iTree, we could quickly, you know, someone could be there saying, these are the benefits of these trees, and this is the yearly dollars in services they provide to us.
One's a 13-inch DBH, one's a 15-inch.
And what are the species?
Northern. Did I say Northern Red Oak or Cordis Bull? I think it's a Cordis Bull. I think they're pin oaks.
All right, I'm happy to run a quick eye tree on them.
Sure.
Okay.
I don't like that. Based upon Terry's conversation, I think the woman is just, you can tell her that.
But you know what? If anyone else is at the hearing.
Yeah, education. Then, all about education.
Then I think it's worth it. And could either of you make it?
Oh, yeah, I'd like to go. I assume I can find them on the public shade tree.
I had to add them. They were not on there. So these are a set of trees that weren't captured.
Weren't captured. Okay. Yeah, I think I can go.
Rob, do you think you can go ahead and look up the iTree benefits, or do you want me to and then send you a link?
I can. You know, the David Tree Survey gives some. You just put in the trees and it gives you a.
Yeah, it's benefit calculator. Yeah, okay. It's both of them do it. Both of them have benefits calculator.
Yeah, I would use that.
Okay, all right.
Just because I'm not sure I can do maybe I can. Probably the same.
I think they're probably the same.
Yeah, they're probably the same.
So Rob, we'll have you do that. Right. That'd be great.
So as Lily mentioned, the meeting, unfortunately, Lily was able to be present, but Todd and I actually did meet with the mayor for, probably about 40 minutes. And, you know, there was really just a very large general discussion about the tree inventory. I talked to him a lot about the actual tree keeper software, which he was interested in because he had not really been given any kind of tutorial on it. So I had my tablet and I gave him a tutorial. So he's fine with utilizing it for, buying a year subscription and allowing us to see if it, the information can be taken out of here and brought into municipality, or do we have a standalone use of their standalone inventory. She was very receptive to it. You know, and we talked about, we did touch upon the subject of social media and things of that nature, and the mayor's feeling is that he would like to, and he said it gets a little convoluted. He said, we typically have not allowed commissions and boards to have their own Facebook pages or Twitter accounts because of how it can be confusing to the public. And he said, to me, it's a little confusing about the relationship between Tree Northampton, the Public Shade Tree Commission, and the city. He said, we kind of explained to him from our last report that you gave us kind of where they are. Todd actually talked to him about it. Mm-hmm. Talked about their where their status is, what their mission's gonna be, and then I kind of plugged in my thought process on how their role has helped us so far, what they've done. So I mean, it was just, you know, just general communication back and forth, so you really didn't miss anything. Okay. Because Lily had she made some bullet points for us to communicate with the mayor specifically about the shade tree inventory. And so we did touch on that because we wanted Lily to actually come to the meeting. So
yeah.
I'm working on getting a meeting rescheduled.
Thank you.
Follow up with
you. And the silver lining, if there is one, is the next day I met with Molly Freilicher and went through that whole bullet list and went through all of the possible leverageable resources we could present to the mayor, and so I just fine-tuned that a little bit.
How did the discussion come out in terms of the relationship with Public Shade Commission, Tree Northampton?
The mayor was all for, the mayor is in favor of having the relationship, but he said there needs to be some kind of refinement of who communicates with whom, how that happens, you know. Does Tree Northampton work with the Public Shade Tree Commission? Do they have a representative that communicates with the commission, you know?
We pretty much got that ironed out.
Well, we have it ironed out, but one of the things that he said is that you have Tree Northampton actually producing documentation that has the city of Northampton information on it. And he said it can, you know, and he said, I don't want Tree Northampton producing press releases or things that are not working in sync with the commission and the tree warden and my office. Mm-hmm. He said, so those kind of things, he said, I just would like to zoom out a little bit and, you know, have a larger conversation about it. He said he would, to be continued, he was not against the commission having their own Facebook page or Twitter. He said, but we just have to make sure that it's managed properly.
Completely.
And anything that happens gets run through his office before anything gets posted and put out there. But he was...
Might be a good point, though, to make sure that Tree Northampton's website really limits the amount of things that look like city things.
Yeah, I mean, from my perspective, I guess I would like to have, and I'm not saying I don't have enough information because things have been kind of quiet, but it would be hopeful for me, because I don't know if they've had any meetings. I don't know if they have because of the winter, because of the weather, but I'd like to go to a meeting.
Yep.
To kind of meet with everyone or talk with everyone.
Yep.
I'd like to know exactly what people's availability is for what types of work would be possible. You know, do we have enough volunteers to actually put a watering crew together this summer? You know, we have the DPW equipment. How would that interface with the volunteers? Mm-hmm. All those kind of things. And so I think that it's great that we have Rob interfacing with them, but I would like to also be part of it, because operationally, if they have some folks that we can utilize, that would be awesome. You know, obviously we're utilizing them for tree planting and doing tree training, but you know, there's maybe some other operational things that we could ask them to work with. And I think one of the things that kind of came up was the yard sign issue.
Yeah.
So I mean, it's not really an issue. It's just that Tree Northampton wants to develop a yard sign that basically, you know, after a tree is planted in someone's yard, or even I was supposed on the tree belt using the volunteers from Tree Northampton and the city and the Public Shade Tree Commission, that they would put a sign there that would say, you know, would you like this tree, would you like this free tree? And so there's some rolling around the different types of language that should be on there. And that was one of the things that the mayor was talking about, and Todd sent us an email, and we haven't sent anything out. Lily and I were emailing with Todd just to try to figure out what kind of communication or what it should look like. And that's kind of something the mayor was touching upon about the different, you have three different groups. He said the Public Shade Tree Commission is part of the city. He said, but obviously you have your volunteers. He said, then you have the city, which actually maintains all the public shade trees and has the operational aspect of things. And then you have the Tree Northampton, he said, so.
See, I only see two entities. I see the city and I see Tree Northampton. We are just, you know, we are all at work for the city. We just happen to be unpaid workers for the city.
That's correct. But I think that he's looking at it from the perspective, you may see it that way, but folks may see it differently. So his perspective was if you're, you know, just a citizen who doesn't really know much about trees, you know, he said, we just gotta make sure the messages aren't confusing. That's really what it is.
Okay.
That's really what he wanted, was his final statement.
We can pick that. We can, I'd like to, yeah, I mean, I'm happy to have that conversation again. I know that there is a precedent. The Northampton Energy Sustainability Commission has a Facebook page. So there's a precedent for a commission having a Facebook page that I presume is managed by a paid staff. So I think the idea of every single message that is posted on the Facebook page has to be approved by the mayor's office, to me that seems extreme. So I would like to push that point.
Good luck.
Yep. I'm happy to take it up. I feel like in the Trump era, it's really important.
But you know what? You also don't want to bite the hand that feeds you.
I hear you.
This is my point. I hear you.
I don't think that it's either or.
It's
I don't think
this
it's either.
Particular.
I also think that these Tree Northampton, in terms of communicating messages, it's pretty open to, you know, as if you want to feed just ideas, links, articles, you know, we're going to be posting one. Positions of the Public Shade Tree Commission, but just sort of tree information.
Mm-hmm.
We are working on that, pictures of trees, whatever.
Okay. All right, so anything else in your report?
No, just we were doing a bunch of tree work, but we kind of had stopped because of the weather. So we've been picking away at the at some of the hazard tree removals.
Oh, you have been?
Yep.
Okay.
Yep, slowly.
Yeah.
So, but we'll get back, nothing next week, we'll be back.
I'd be interested in knowing, now that you're getting into them, how much their evaluation and yours differ.
That's why I have to evaluate every single one of them. You know, I have to go into a site visit before we make a determination. And then we're finding some trees as well, too, that have to be programmed. We have a monitor list that we hold on to, that we do six-month inspections, which is part of tree risk assessment, as you all know. So
have you started to look at some of their evaluations?
Yes, yep. And I haven't found anything that was so far than I found, other than that tree up on Warner Street, everything's better than I've been in agreement with them.
Okay, good, that's good.
Yeah.
Well, it's good, except it means there's a lot of trees to
Well, yeah.
Well, there are. And I mean, I think when you have all this raw data, you know, this is what happens when you produce a study of this sort. You know, you have all this information, and okay, so now what are you going to do with it? How are you going to implement parts of it? Are you going to implement some of it, all of it? You know, and I think this is, like any study, it's you have to implement them, you have to implement things methodically.
Yeah.
So.
What were there, 909?
Yes.
Trees and the urgent removed.
Yes, but part of the issue too is that some of the trees that, you know, may have been captured on the inventory are not city trees, and that's because of the our database that we have, which is askew. And then there's trees that, for example, on Park Hill Road, the two trees that are in question are city shade trees that are not now they're in there, but they weren't in there before.
Mm-hmm.
So it's just. It's just,
did they do Park Hill Road?
Yep. Yeah. But the way that the you know, if you take a tape measure and use the actual card file that we have, those trees are within the public right of way.
Okay.
If you use the assessor's database, they are not in the public right of way.
Mm-hmm. Okay, and that's what they use, the assessor's database?
Yeah, because it would be impossible for them to, it would have taken them 2 years.
Yeah, so this was nothing, this was not an oversight on their part?
No, no, it's in that second, it's in that 5%, 3 to 5% margin of error.
Okay, yeah.
That they, you know, that they will have, so.
Okay.
And I don't really think I have anything else to report, other than I did order the whips.
You ordered the whips?
Terry ordered the whips.
Okay. Yeah, well, we're going to talk about Arbor Day next, actually, and that's a fine segue to it. So if you don't have anything else to say on your report, then let's go to Arbor Day, okay. So Arbor Day feels like, I'm a little nervous about it, frankly, because I don't know what, I want to clarify where the leadership is for the different projects. My understanding after one meeting, at least I thought, was that Tree of Northampton was going to take, was going to manage all volunteering scheduling around the Arbor Day whip distribution. Did I have that right?
It's not what we had said, I don't believe.
Okay, then let's, that's item number one.
Where I felt we left it was that we intended to have at least one person there the whole time. But with, usually, Rich or someone from the DB, there are often other people there.
And this would be on the actual Arbor Day? Is that what you're planning?
Right, well, it's actually, usually there are 2 days that it takes place in the Arbor Day.
The Friday and Saturday.
Usually, I mean, I would think that easily we would like to have someone from Tree of Northampton there the whole time.
Okay, we currently then don't have anyone scheduling volunteers for, that could be with that single volunteer, unless you're comfortable with there just being one person there the whole time. So we need someone to at least.
I can send out a survey to see who's available for the Friday, Saturday slots.
Right, I mean, there have been people that have shown up over the years.
Yeah.
I don't know if they've disappeared.
I still have that volunteer list from last year.
For who did it last year? Okay, and we also gave that entire volunteer list to Tree Northampton. So I guess my question is, do you want Marilyn to do it, or does Tree Northampton want to do that?
Well, Marilyn, because I think we should ask the people who came last year and year before. There are some regulars who come, and I'm not sure who they are, and I don't think I can pick them off the list.
So does that feel manageable to you?
Yeah.
So you're taking on the volunteer management of those 2 days?
Yep.
Got it, great, okay.
And just to clarify the hours, I know Saturday we're gonna do, is it 9 to noon, Rich?
Yeah, we could do 8, we could even do 8:30, we could do 8.
8 to noon.
Yeah, I think.
Yeah, and you usually have someone there and it sets up. And
yeah, we have usually 2 or 3 staff people.
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
We usually have 2, but it depends if we do plantings.
If you have 2 or 3, then I always feel like the Tree Northampton person is enough.
I do too. That's how I left it at the meeting, but I didn't want to decide.
Well, I can oversee that process just to make sure that the survey covers.
Yeah. I mean, it's true if we're planting. At the same time, it will maybe draw, you know, might confuse things.
Yeah, if we're going to do a planting, if we're going to do any kind of plantings, or if I'm going to do some kind of a planting on Friday, then it's going to take away from the staff is going to be working. You know, we'll set everything up. Maybe one staff person will stay here, but the rest of us will have to do some plantings.
No, it should be enough. A tree, you know, a tree with one person, one staff person. So we kind of cover it. It would be great, Marilyn, to have you overseeing our efforts.
I can help with the planting.
Okay.
I'm going to move on to the tree planting. So I think we're stuck in email land where we just need to identify the day we're doing this planting. And it looks like the last place we left it
was we parked April 22nd.
22nd, which is Earth Day.
Yep.
So can I go back to the environmental club at NHS?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, that loop just wasn't tied.
Yep.
So Saturday, April 22nd, and you prefer to do it in the morning because
earlier. Yep.
So do you want to give us a time frame?
We could do it 8, 9.
Okay.
Depends how many trees you want to plant. That's the other thing, so at the high school, if you want to even plant at the high school.
Well, okay, so then Jen wrote at the high school, because she did the drive-by.
Yeah, she did do the drive-by.
And she said, there are quite a few trees there, repetition of species, but quite diverse overall. There do seem to be a few spots that trees could be planted. But before I go into these details, Rich, I'll say that the previous email that I got from you is that you expressed doubt that the grounds people, we're not giving them a lot of time at this point. We're giving them like 1 month. So I can go into some nitty gritty here, or we can go, well, we didn't give ourselves enough time, we need to plant somewhere else.
I think it would be good to try to reach out to them and see if we can actually get a couple of trees planted on the school property. Because I mean, I think tying it together with the students, I think that's kind of key.
So you're going to need to be that person.
I will be that person, providing the, if I have the ability to actually say that the environmental club at Northampton High and the tree warden, the public shade tree commissioner are sponsoring tree plantings, and we want to plant multiple trees on high school property, that would be the way to approach it. And I'll send that email right to the superintendent.
Okay, all right. We probably need to have a backup plan.
Okay.
If that doesn't work out. So you have the email that Jen wrote, and she wrote corner of Milton and Old Elm Street, street currently lined with Zelkovas, or on Old Elm Street turns into Nonotoc. She just has a number of sites.
On school property or off?
I'm going to forward this to you too, Rob. Do you want to see it, Jay?
Yeah.
Okay.
It could be just different. If they're off school property, it's really easy to at least have it as a backup lined up and ready to go.
Yeah, I don't know. It's not clear to me. Yeah. I'm not sure.
Do we already have the trees?
We're going to end up utilizing. Well, we have some trees in the holding area, but we also have trees.
There'll be a phone that are going to be delivered on June 30th.
Yeah, that we still own that are in Amherst Nursery. But I think it depends upon the location and the size of the trees that we can get in there. We can do large trees.
We're thinking at least two or more?
I think two. I mean, it all depends upon how many students actually turn out.
Yeah, she talks about 10 to 15 students, so I don't feel like two trees is enough for that.
No, probably not. It depends what type of tree we're going to select, obviously, if it's B&B, and then we could probably do three in the morning easily, I would think. Yeah. With a couple of old timers that know what they're doing.
Yeah, Saturday morning, that was my best time.
It's not, no, do you work Saturdays?
I'm taking a class.
Okay.
The high schoolers are really good at digging.
Yeah.
So I've got to contact the high school's environmental club right away.
Okay.
And let them know about the 22nd. Nine a.m. Okay. And I'll just ask her how many. You know, it's that is what? That's the science march, so there's a good chance they won't be going to that because the climate march is just the next weekend. Mm-hmm. Okay. Once we get all this wrapped up, I really think that we got a press release to send out about Arbor Day, especially if it's going to be on, if there's an event on Earth Day, which is great.
Earth Day is the 22nd.
Event
being the tree planting?
Yeah.
And I was actually thinking on Arbor Day itself, that Friday we could do, I would like to try to plant a couple of trees downtown.
On Friday?
Yeah.
The 28th?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Sort of like what we did last year. We had, we did the one tree in front of Thorns, but there's other tree wells downtown that could be, we could plant some of those other locusts that we have. We could also just go down and do on Bridge Street.
That strip.
We could start working on that strip. We have 500 locusts that are going in that strip in front of the antique shop.
Great.
So we have a couple places we can start that process.
Okay, well, I would just like to hold out there the possibility of doing that on Earth Day with the students. Just so, if you're gonna have 10 students, that they all feel like they're doing something, and not standing around watching a pit being dug by one another.
So what we could do, if there are five, then we've got two, you know, we could add some other leaders in, so that there'd be four leaders. And so each, two students would have a leader in each plant of tree. Give everybody a really hands-on experience.
So you could say the high school would be our, obviously our first priority. We could get some trees planted there, and then our second priority would be in the downtown area.
I'd say they're equal priority, mind you.
Okay.
You know, I think that the public benefit of downtown is gonna be greater than probably some edge of, you know, the boundary of the school. It's probably not gonna be right anywhere where it's gonna provide a lot of, like, direct benefit to.
So, Rich, is that really a possibility, right? If both of you come to have you each on a tree with two students, and then have a few other leaders, and we could just plant all five, and then it would be kind of a, you know, getting that model of planting a whole strip that people here have talked about, like, being a little more aggressive, but getting more done.
That would be great.
So do you want me to, do you want me not to press the issue?
No, why not? Because at least it's planting a seed for next year.
Okay.
And then, because if you do get pushback, you can just say, then let this be an early conversation for a year from now. And either way, when I reach out to Gretchen, I'm gonna tell her that it's going to be either, it's gonna be and/or the high school or downtown.
Okay.
High school and/or downtown. Okay, is there anything else about Arbor Day?
No, just leave the bag, leave the bag all the whips.
What kind did you get this year?
You included lilacs.
We did, I included lilacs, so we have 500 altogether. Red bud, sweet gum.
Better than last year's stuff.
There are spruce again?
You guys are asking a lot of questions, I'm like.
Sorry.
I didn't ask this question, but.
Are there oaks?
Oh, we got oak, and I forgot the other one. It's actually what we had talked about, it's in your, embedded in your email.
Yeah.
And it was in your email as well, because I only got two responses.
Five types, then?
We got five types, yeah. And any of the leftover trees that we've had in the last few years, we planted them at Spring Grove Cemetery.
How are they doing?
They seem to be doing okay, as long as they keep up the watering, the park guys, they really just run soaker hoses.
Here it is, sweet gum, kusa, red bud, red oak are what I recommended. And what did you end up getting? I can tell you all the ones that were available.
Everything that was on your list.
Well, okay, there's four things, plus you added lilacs.
Plus lilacs, because they're hot cakes.
I know, but that's almost why I didn't want them to be off.
I know, but the thing is that, you know, the thing is, you say, you know, you want that lilac?
Yeah.
You gotta take this tree. It's like a two-for-one deal. Because if it gets to that point, I mean, it works, all right. I don't have room for two, but I'll take two.
Just the quickest. Are you planting them out at the cemetery as a nursery, or is that's their final place?
That's their final place. Yeah.
Their eternal resting place.
I mean, we could pull them out if we wanted to. But I planted, we had a part of our condition when we built the building up there, the main building, is we had to create a buffer between the back of where the graves are backed up in the building. So we're using the trees as the buffers, plus beautification, so.
Okay, let's move along.
Okay.
I do want to suggest one more thing for Arbor Day. I feel like it's always nice to have some kind of educative component. And I would be willing to co-author with you, Rich, some kind of op-ed piece. You know, we've not yet had an op-ed piece in the paper on some aspect of it. It could even be the watering aspect of it, because that's the part we're most nervous about, like, that we're planting all these trees and we really need, I don't know. Anyway, you and I can think about the content, but I feel like it's an opportunity to highlight the importance of trees. And so it's, if you're interested, I would basically draft it. and, you know, you could give feedback, and then we could co-author it and submit it to the Gazette.
Fine.
Okay.
Is that instead of a press release, or in a...
No.
No, press release would be, press release would be something that you guys would have input and craft, and then do what you did last year. It would go to the mayor's office, and then I'd push it all my way to make sure he puts out at the time.
Yeah. Okay. Planting priorities for this spring. Do folks want to huddle around my lap? I'm going to take this off. My laptop in the absence of me being able to project it. Because I'm excited to show folks a little bit about what Molly trained me on. And what up? Rich? So this is an aspect of iTree called iTree Tools. So it's iTreeTools.org. And under iTree Tools, you have a whole bunch of apps. And one of them is iTree Landscape. So when you click onto that, you have Welcome to iTree Landscape, Get Started. You're going to see that I've already identified Northampton's, but if in the absence of that, you put in the zip code where you are. It gives you a zone, and then you select the exact parameters of that zone. So here it is, Northampton. And all of these little divisions are census blocks. So the last census in Northampton was in 2011.
You mean each blue?
Each one of these blue divided areas is a census block. And a census block is divided, I think, evenly by population. So this is an unpopulated area, which is why it's an enormous census block. Whereas this right down here is the jail. Huh. Wow. And so it's a densely packed census block. And I kept wondering why, like when I would search for low income, like that would always flash bright color. And it's because that's why. Okay, so I'm gonna...
He was remembering when it was a jail.
It's the current jail. Yeah. Okay. All right. So let's get started. Basically, you're marching through these things, which is find the location, which we've just done, explore location data, see tree benefits, prioritize tree planting, and generate results. So you hit next. And what you've got is, so now we are... we've got a bunch of tabs here. So this is of this whole area. This is the canopy and impervious area. So we have 22,000 acres. Canopy represents 58% of that. So that's pretty impressive. You know, the whole Northampton, this is not distinguishing public shade tree by anything. It's just the canopy represents 58.6% of the total acreage. Impervious surface area is less than 9%. Plantable space is 33%, okay? And then you can look at these different areas. You can just play with these. You know, census data, if you open this up, you're gonna see by each one of these census blocks, you're gonna see things like the population size, population that's under 5 years old, under 18, et cetera, et cetera. You know, you guys can just play around with this as you want. For the purposes of our thing, I'm not going to get hung up on that. And then forest risk. I find that these categories are not very helpful because forest risk data is so zoomed out that dividing it within census blocks doesn't really give you any helpful information. Okay. Hey, hi David. All right, so tree benefits. You've got carbon, air pollution, and hydrology. So here it's telling you that there
are... What is he doing awake?
I know, 2.5 hours of sleep last night.
It's a rest.
I'm working on it.
So this is telling us that our entire tree canopy is providing $80 million worth of carbon storage. And this is the yearly carbon sequestration. I don't really know what these means.
Should email it to Scott Pruitt immediately.
Oh, yeah. This is air pollution, so this is pounds of these different air pollutants that is taking out of the air.
So this is for all trees in Northampton, public, private,
yes, everything. This is everything. And then hydrology, so that's like stormwater mitigation, things like that. All right, so then as you keep going, this is where it gets interesting and relevant to our prioritizing trees, okay? So I did a search already, and you customize your search. And you can customize it according to numbers of different things. What I did is I had it search for three things. Those areas that had low tree stocking level, combined with those areas that had, wait, this is actually not what I did. This is the default, is low tree stocking level, low tree cover per capita, and high population density. I would actually change this one. I like the census, so it's got a whole census data, tons of categories, you know, demographic. And I go to low median income. So what this
low
is,
medium?
Low median income. So what it means is that which zones have, relative to the other census block areas, lower median income. Mm-hmm. So I'm doing a search for areas that are equally low median, have low tree cover capita, and are highly populated, or densely populated. And I'm dividing each of these 30, 30, 40. You can change the weight of any of these. So for example, if you wanna say, I really wanna prioritize low income areas, okay? So I'm gonna make that 60%. So that means I have to bring everything to 100. Right now it's at 130. So let me make this 20, and I'll make this 20 as well. And then update map display. So what you're seeing is the darker reds are the priority areas. So ignore this clearly, because this is the jail. And this is the VA.
Oh, it's the current jail, that red.
It's the current jail, and this is the Veterans Hospital grounds, okay? So, and by the way, you can open this and make this more or less transparent.
So what is
the, let's zoom in. Yeah. So what we're saying is these are the areas that best match my priorities for low income, low tree cover, and high population density. So then if I make this more transparent, and we're looking at these two areas, and we zoom in, we're getting, well, you know, there's a lot of rental properties. So you have to think about people who are low income that rent in these areas. So this is downtown, it's a lot of downtown, around Smith College.
Can you zoom a little more?
Sure. And you know what, this might be another little confounder, Jay, because it could be that students fill out this census data, and the students like have no income, right?
Yeah.
So they're dependent on their parents. So this could be not useful,
yeah.
But could this area be useful? So this area is off Prospect, in between Prospect and King Street, I think,
yeah.
Right?
Mm-hmm.
This is nothing.
That I see as a dancing pool.
Potential, yeah, exactly. Okay, so that's
very few trees.
So you know, you could do this in any numbers of ways. Like if we wanted to change the priorities, let me get rid of this just to get out of the way.
And then these other areas are also less so.
Yeah, I mean they're more significant than this or this, right? But also, it's all how you weigh this. Like, do you want to change this so that we give low tree cover a higher weight, and then you bring everything else back, you know? Map display. Okay, so this is where we've weighted, that's the jail again. This is where we've weighted low tree canopy over the other things.
the other two things. So basically, it's telling us a little bit about downtown. Now these are popping out. This is popping out a little bit more.
What do we think that is, Jenny, in the area?
That's Florence, that's like...
That's like the Spring Grove Avenue.
Oak, that's Molly's neighborhood.
Yeah, Oak, Lake, Bardwell.
Yeah.
Sterling.
This is High Street.
A lot of lawns, basically.
Yeah.
A lot of lawns.
Yeah. So, you know, I feel like this is a little bit of a, it's a blunt instrument. It's not like a precision scalpel. But it's, you know, it's interesting, and we can, you know, again, I just chose those three criteria. You can choose others. You could, let's see what else. There's a ton of them. But a lot of these are just kind of related to poverty. You know, high income, single family home, single parent homes kind of thing. These, I feel like, are not going to provide us much valuable information. Because I just don't trust this data on this local of a level. That's my instinct.
What kind of data are those?
This is probably U.S. Forest Service data. It's things like, it's all related to high surface drinking water importance. You know, it's just not going to vary that much from census block to census block.
Yep.
Because the census doesn't collect this data. Mm-hmm. So I think that it almost applies evenly to all these areas. So I find the census data is especially interesting. Low minority percent. Let me see if there's a high minority percent. High poverty percent? I guess that's this, not that different than low median income. Yeah. Okay. So that's the first thing I wanted to show you, is using this. You guys can go on and fiddle around with it. The next step would be actually to generate results and to print it out. And for some reason, this function is not working. We could neither export the data nor print out report. So we're going to always have to just look at this online. Okay, the other thing I wanted to show you is what Rob helped me walk through with my tree keeper. So I'm going to just go back to my tree keeper and reload. So it's going to immediately, it's going to immediately show every data point in the entire database. So then I go to this, layers, and I'm going to just take everything away. And then I go down to this search button, and I hit switch to advanced search. And Rob helped me, I would have never found this. You go to species, and you select vacant. Never, ever found this.
Kind of tree.
And I'm interested in vacant sites that can accommodate large trees. Okay, so I select that and I hit search. And these are all the vacant spots that can currently support large trees. So I did a rough little count of how many of those fall along the major gateways. I think of three gateways. I think of Route 9, which goes across the bridge, you know, onto Leeds, etc. Route 5, which is Pleasant and King Street. And then Route 10, which is the road to East Hampton. And I did a kind of a back of the envelope count, and I counted, I'm just gonna pull this up. I counted 26 possible sites for large trees on Route 9, 8 to 12 on Route 10, and I say 8 to 12 because remember how we planted some trees that can be pulled out and replaced by bigger trees. And then I counted 7 on Route 5.
King Street,
basically. Well, here's the problem. I'm going to actually zoom in on that because this is not no. Oh. And here's why. Hold on a second.
Oh, it could be way out.
It's a lot of them are right here. Let's zoom in.
Entrance there to the island.
Yeah, and isn't that state property? Look at this, Rich.
We are...
It's on the rotary. This is, you know, the new rotary. This is, you know, exit 18.
We that's been changed. I think we either, we are not responsible to the Rotary or to the cut in the flood control, right?
And what about these? It depends on the day.
I have to see. The bowling alley is the building on the left?
Yeah.
Yep, so if it's the flood control type is where our cutoff is now, and where, those are our locations.
Okay, all right. There were actually very few on King Street. Like, maybe two.
Okay.
For large? For large.
Yeah, but we have to remember that this is according to the
Just on the street here.
The rules that Davey has, which are different rules than we have. It's 40 feet from a power line, more than 6 feet.
Correct.
For tree belt.
So there's a lot of criteria.
Can I just say something about that? When I sat down with Molly, and she heard that in our pre-inventory meeting, we had clarified that we wanted more liberality with regard to that, and that they didn't deliver that, she feels like that's a non-deliverable, and that we should actually go back and have them make that correction.
Well, we didn't express it to them at the outset.
It's too late. It's absolutely too late.
I mean, we could have. We did express it.
Totally.
Oh, really?
Yeah. Were you at that meeting that
originally?
Yeah, you were there. You remember.
Yeah.
Too late. Bill's been paid.
But do you think they do it out of the courtesy of their heart?
I don't think so, because they have to go back to each tree.
It would be considered at this point a change order to a contract that's been
completely resolved.
That's been completely executed.
Yeah. Okay.
But I mean, each tree you'd have to go back to, because they don't know why they rated it. They don't have a note saying it's because of the width of the tree belt or because of a wire. So every single tree.
Well, here's what we do know. We do know that all of these can accommodate large trees. That we know, like, very, very generously they can accommodate large trees. So if we were trying to go from, like, low-hanging fruit, it feels like this is a good place to start.
Mm-hmm. I don't agree at all. I just, there are probably hundreds and hundreds of places that we could put large trees that are much more central and that we can do whole strips of. Like, there are on King Street. There's like 10 places in a row with the large trees.
Okay. Right.
So that would be much more, and these are next to sidewalks where there are lots of people.
It's just so frustrating, because that's why we did this inventory.
Right.
And now what you're describing, Rob, is like one of us having to go back and identify all these places.
I'm doing it.
Not systematically all of them,
but in other words, I will walk up the whole of King Street and I'll find every place. Like, if we're going to do King Street now, like we weren't doing it because we were holding back from doing gateways because we were afraid that we weren't coordinated. So, I mean, it's been on purpose that we haven't been doing gateways. But now that we are doing King Street, I'll walk the whole King Street, find every large tree, and then we'll do King Street. The whole, you know, we'll start doing all of King Street.
Uh-huh. I think we're done with this part of it. So should we sit back around the table and continue this conversation?
You know, in part, it's a complicated process. I mean, because in doing King Street, there's some people on side street on King Street. That whole thing, the low density all the way to Prospect, from King to Prospect.
Yeah.
Because that doesn't have enough treatment. So that's an area to concentrate on.
Mm-hmm. Prospect.
Yeah, everything between Prospect.
Oh, I see what you're talking about. Yeah. Like Stoddard.
Yeah. And so right now, I mean, I have a big plan to, like, you know, to get trees on Stoddard and also Hooker. There are people around there who are beginning to ask for trees. And so it's an opportunity to join together with the community, because that's another part of it, uh-huh. and to plant large trees in that area. So, you know, it's not easily done, but I've also found that when selecting sites,
can I just hold off on something? We don't have a quorum anymore.
Oh, okay.
So let's just wait till Jay comes back.
Yeah, I agree. Yeah.
Non-tree matters?
Yeah.
Yeah, we're not sitting here silently.
Well, the different marches.
Right.
Yeah.
You're going to one.
Okay. I'm
going
to go to the climate march. Yeah.
This is the second one, which is the 28th.
I'm going to the science one.
It's the 29th, yeah.
29th. So you're going.
22nd.
Yeah.
So that then has you not having a problem with the Arbor Day? Is that it?
I will have a problem with Arbor Day, personally.
Because that's on the...
Arbor Day is on the 28th.
On the 28th.
Yeah, okay. I'll probably be on the route to DC.
The tree planting is the week before.
The tree planting would be on the 22nd.
The tree planting at the high school on the 22nd.
The week before, okay.
But then the ones that we may do downtown on the 28th?
I think that really all depends.
Oh, no, but.
The outcome of the.
What the outcome of the school, planning at the school, if we push some pushback.
So now that we have a quorum, I don't think that it's possible at this meeting to sort through all the issues of how trees get selected in terms of where they go, because it's so infinitely complex. I mean, it has to do with the neighborhood, what people will sort of tolerate or what they want, how many setback trees you can get. I mean.
We're not talking about setback trees. We're talking about public shade trees.
But the public shade trees, so what happens is you go to a street and say it has a terrible little, a 3-foot tree belt and a whole bunch of yards. I don't feel that good about having us just go and put the trees into the tree belt without trying to get setback trees first. So, because that allows for a really wonderful canopy, whereas the tree belt trees, their survival rate is not as good. It becomes something the city has to maintain forever, and it doesn't have the same buy-in from homeowners. There's a whole bunch of reasons why I find the setback trees to be important to do first, especially because some of the tree belts aren't so wonderful. I mean, it's different on South Street, where the tree belt is wonderful. It's huge. But like on Elm Street, on one side of the street, it's not very big and it's got wires overhead. Mm-hmm. So every time, it is possible to put them in the tree belt and then in the yard, but in many cases, you're very much more likely to get a tree in the yard if you don't have one in the tree belt. So.
Okay, so I don't disagree with you that that there are many variables that come into play with deciding, but I do disagree with you that we can't figure out a short-term plan and execute it. It's a matter of, it may not be perfect and it may need to be tweaked, but I think that going into the spring with a general plan about what our priorities are for planting is a reasonable thing for us to do.
Right, I agree, but I think that we had a priority to not plant gateways for a while. This is something you would suggest.
Until the inventory was done.
Right, and now we have the inventory. So I think it is a good priority to plant gateways.
Okay.
But in order to figure out what that means in terms of trees and where they go, using iTree or using the survey is not a very good way, I don't think.
Well, it's a tool. So first of all, I want to make sure I hear from the other people too. So, but I'll just say one more thing, and that is, it's an imperfect tool. We figured out how imperfect it is, but actually it's a tool that is so imperfect that if we err on the side of planting in those sites, we know they're, or we have a strong suspicion that they are good sites, that they're that they're generous tree belts, that they're generous non-interference with utilities, and we can at least identify those sites on gateways, which we have identified as priorities. We've always identified gateways as priorities. We've just postponed it until we have a tree inventory. So I'm wondering how we can blend these things. And it might be the third thing we need to blend is Rob's on-the-ground reconnaissance. And maybe you only have time this spring, Rob, to recon King Street. But then we could go, okay, great. Well, then let's focus on King Street, large sites, it's a gateway, So that's what I'm saying.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I mean, I only picked King Street because there are people have spoken about wanting like series of rows, and there would have to be a row that could have large trees in it.
I like that idea of combining all three efforts, the results from the inventory, which we invested in. But what a fantastic tool this is. And then Rob on the ground surveying, making certain streets or areas of town gateways priority. It's a good starting point.
I think we also need to coordinate that with the planning department and see what they've got in the works or in their minds as to what might happen in those areas.
Yeah.
You mean to the roads?
redoing the roads?
Redoing any part of, you know, I know gateways were a big thing for a while, and I'm sure they still are with the planning department.
Are you referring specifically to King Street? Because King Street, the one thing is that whenever there's like a new car dealership coming in or something, the planning department uses that as a leverage to get them to plant on the tree belt. I don't know that they've done a great job planting on the tree belt. But at least the way Wayne justifies it is the city's getting free trees. You know, again, I don't know how we feel about that. But are you thinking any other gateways could be at risk of the city having large plans?
I just know the roundabout they built there. We talked years ago about developing a park right on the corner of that street that goes into where the wastewater treatment.
Well, that's part of the Pleasant Street plan now, is to put a little pocket park in.
I'm just saying, we need to.
Yeah.
And at this meeting, it was.
We need to be aware of that and coordinate.
It was stated that we shouldn't plant on Pleasant Street because of the work that's being done. Isn't that right?
Yeah.
So Pleasant Street.
Pleasant Street's out.
Oh, so.
I agree. Except for maybe the part that we just looked at, which is around the roundabout.
Yes, I have to find out from the city engineer where our layout is.
And also, somewhere in there, there's a swale on, maybe that's Conn's.
That's Conn Street.
Yeah, which I guess we don't plant in, is that?
No, it's correct, it's a stormwater.
And then also, some people along there, like the hotel near the bowling alley, for whatever you think of it, they did already do some landscaping there.
So can we think about low-hanging fruit here, ones where we're not entering into a snarl, but ones that are pretty straightforward? Like when I looked at that tree keeper for large trees on gateways, I saw numbers that could be planted along North Main Street in Florence. You know, that seem like they're in people's front yards because there aren't sidewalks on.
On the other side.
Yeah, I mean, you've already done some. You know which ones, you know what I'm referring to? So I'm just wondering if we can pick a gateway or maybe two gateways and really focus on, look at where the sites are identified for large trees, try to identify others and at least demonstrate that we have a thoughtful plan that considers our priorities.
The problem is that there's so many conflicting statements that have been here, and I agree with that. For instance, that instead of planting trees in one area and then not completing the area, you should complete an area. And so if you're going to plant large trees, you have to plant small trees if you're going to complete an area. In other words, Todd specifically was saying, you know, plant a street, you know, don't just plant a few trees and leave. So that kind of means that you aren't just planting large trees, you're just.
And of Todd's remark, are you in favor of that approach?
Yes.
Okay. I'm trying to understand. Like, let's try to move from the problem is to the solution is.
Yes.
So you're identifying an approach that instead of, because this is just one way of slicing, and there's a million different ways to slice this.
Right.
So instead of focusing on getting large trees in the ground, you want to focus on a street and plant maximally in that street. And would you agree that that street should be a gateway street?
Right, so I think we should take gateways and then we should try and plant them as best we can with the trees that we have. So you have to take into consideration which trees we have available. So each season. So as we go through different seasons, different trees will become available. In other words, any one season, we only have probably a hand. We only probably have a few trees that are suitable for a gateway that are large trees because they have to be salt tolerant and they have to be large trees. And
that's presuming that we're only using Amherst Nursery, right?
Well, yeah, I mean, you could possibly reach out to other nurseries, but the stock is tended to cost twice as much and be of relatively inferior quality. I mean, the initial plantings we did with Jay when we did the demonstrations in that cemetery were, some of those trees were.
Well, those trees were containers.
Yeah, some were containers, they weren't good, but also some of the B&B trees were.
And what about, trying Bear Root again?
Yeah, we can try that.
Timing, it's just timing. It's just a timing issue. It's got to be all fall planting. It's, you know, even Andy Hillman, who planted a gazillion Bear Root trees, so really, you're very risky to do it in the spring.
Yep, I would agree with that.
But I think, you know, trying to get a greater, the thing is that over time, you get a great variety of trees by waiting for Amherst Nursery to come up with the trees. It's just a matter of, in other words, they keep changing their, the stock.
Come up with a plan and do it in steps.
Yeah.
I feel like we need a plan, guys. I mean, I understand that we may not be able to execute the plan all at once.
I think that, I agree with you, you can't execute the plan, which obviously, we can see through the David report how much work there has to be done out there. So that's just a good example. And this is just a small little piece of that whole report.
Right, they identified like 2,000.
That's correct.
Sites.
So a couple of thoughts. First of all, I think what's really important piece that we're not talking about is the fact that we actually need the list of trees that we recommend to plant. We have to have that list in order to, so that list will drive us as to where and how we get the nursery stock to plant.
I thought that list is done. You mean the list that Jen and Jay
put together? Yes, so okay. It would be nice to adopt that list and say, this is the list. First of all, this is the list that we as the Public Shade Tree Commission and the Tree Ward recommend for plantings within the city. So we can actually have that list for ourselves to use, have that list for the planning department, because yes. The list that they have is kind of abysmal at this point. So that's the first step. The second step is we have two tree planting programs in a sense. We have the setback planting program that we've relied upon, which has been really by Rob spotting places to plant trees himself or by residents requesting trees. So it's been all over the place. So you have tree here, tree there, tree here, tree there. And we've been kind of moving, we've been using the setback planning and we've been deciding ourselves where to plant street trees. That program, the setback planning program, is extremely important. I think we still need to continue to fund that. However, we have a new tool in our toolbox, which is telling us that here we have these large planting locations that were recommended by Davey, which Lily showed us. However, we know that there are 10 more places on King Street that we can do large planting locations as well. So we need to take the data that we have with that and actually decide to plant, you know, obviously the lower end of Pleasant Street. If we can plant beyond the limit of work and their city's trees, the large trees, then we should plant large trees over there, providing we can get the large trees that are on the list that we recommend. So it's all kind of stuck together. And at the same time, we can still continue to do the setback planting program. But I think picking streets where we can actually have a large impact that is very visual, and gateways, I think, would be a great place to start. Lower end of Route 5, King Street. I would agree with North Main Street. Mm-hmm. Because North Main Street's not going to change. You know, Pleasant Street's going to change, but we don't have any control over that at the moment. The lower end of Pleasant Street is not going to change now.
Elm, there's no problem. Okay, I want to make sure. Mary, put her hand up and then Jay has it.
Sorry, that's fine.
That's okay.
The way I would approach this, I'll just put it on the table, is let's identify approximately how many trees we can realistically plant in terms of what we have in our budget to pay for them and what we have in terms of staffing. Because I acknowledge that you and your crew have a lot of work to do in terms of removing trees and responding to concerns. And then so let's just say that number is 100. And then to be fair, would divide that list into what the inventory recommended, what we're finding on these tools, what you're finding on the ground, Rob, and additionally, what folks are asking for. And just sort of a certain percentage of, all right, 5% of the trees that we plant will be ones that are requested by residents so that they feel like we're being responsive. And that way it might cover all the grounds. And you know, within that plan, as a group, identify the areas, whether it's the gateways or other high visibility places where we want to see these trees planted. So how many, and then categorize and know that we have it in our budget to afford all that in terms of time and money.
Okay. Jay, wait, sorry, Jay.
I think you both have laid out a pretty good plan. I think it'll all work together if we do that. I like both your ideas. They seem to be kind of complementing each other.
I think everything that comes out of these meetings.
Well, yeah. Just the way you worded it was very clear.
I think it's just important, and it's important to show. Sometimes I feel by doing the plantings all over the city that the impact, people don't see the impact.
Yeah.
The individual people that we deal with, the people that request things, the volunteers, they see the impact. You drive on the street, yeah, I was part of that planting. Oh, yeah, I was part of that planting. Oh. But when you actually do a gateway, or you do like the three trees you planted over by the medical center, people see those, right? All three of them, wow, look at that, it came out of nowhere. And I think it's important to balance the two. And then, of course, we're always going to have to add planting sites to the inventory, because let's be realistic, Davey didn't catch everything. So that's Rob's point. I mean, you know, I hear Rob, you know, like there's 10 places on King Street that never got captured. So
well, they're captured, but they're captured in small trees.
Right. So again, it's just like me going out doing a tree inspection. You have to go to these. If we're saying we're going to plant 30 trees on King Street, for example, then we have to go to all 30 locations to look at them to make sure that the trees that we have available to us according to our list can fit in these places. Is it really a small site, or is it really a large site? And it's just a matter of, I feel like we just need to pick a place and we need to plant some trees.
Yeah.
And continue the setback planting program.
Rob, and then I'd like to say something.
Right, so it has seemed random, but I do feel there's always some kind of strong logic behind it. And for instance, it hasn't been random on North Street. We've planted many large trees on North Street, many. And so there's a street that was very visible, a lot of people walk on it. And now there are tulip trees, oak trees, maple trees, linden trees, almost the whole length of that street, all setback trees. So there was kind of a focus when we want to have a focus, and that's sort of short of a gateway. We can have the same focus on a gateway that we had on North Street. At the same time, even though people don't think there's an impact there, the amount of attention you get when you go for a tree, when you go to a neighborhood and plant a tree, is pretty large. People really notice when you plant a tree. So I feel like we're reaching out into neighborhoods that otherwise might be totally unaware. And it is why I would like the sign that we can put up so that people that walk by. And I think it's very important to spread out through the whole city into the neighborhoods, because that's where the setback trees are going to be most successful.
Mm-hmm. I would like us to experiment with the idea of getting focused. It means sacrificing some aspects of our larger tree program, but it's like this spring, let's try focusing on one or two gateways. And the efficiency there is that we're geographically centered, so all of the materials, all the volunteers are just more centrally located. When we had a scattershot approach, I think we found that it was a little bit more inefficient. So I think to do that well, I would like to suggest that we not just look at the tree inventory, but also ask Rob if you're willing to, once we identify one or two gateways that we focus on, maybe corroborate with the tree inventory or alter it as needed. And
I do always look at the tree inventory as I'm walking.
Yeah.
I mean, back and forth.
I feel like there's, Route 10 has tons of, I counted 26 trees on the inventory there.
including Elm Street, which has tremendous amount of walkable potential, and has an enormous tree belt on one side that has not been, is not been exhausted for its spots. And then the other one that I feel like we need to just finish, because we started it, but we need to swap out some trees, is South Street. And I feel like if we just start with just those two streets and do them well, the impact will be great, because there's high pedestrian traffic, there's high car traffic, and, you know, I just feel like it's justified.
That was King, Elm, and South?
No, it was just Route 10, which, you know, Route 10 goes all the way from Coolidge Bridge all the way north through Leeds. So it's like the main, Route 10 is Main Street. Bridge Street, Main Street, Elm Street, North Main Street.
What's really sad about Bridge Street, though, is that our layout ends at Grand Avenue.
Yeah.
So anything that goes from Grand Avenue to the bridge, which is pretty much the, it's all state layout, and most of the trees that were on the left-hand side of that tree belt were Norwood maples, and most of them have all been cut down.
And we can't, like, it's illegal for us to touch that area?
You can get permission. What's going to happen is you're going to get permission from, you can probably get permission from Mass Highway to plant there, but the Mass Highway is going to say you're responsible for the tree care.
Okay.
But the problem with that is that they're really, so if something happens to one of those trees and it becomes a liability situation, those trees are not city trees, they're state trees. From my perspective, I think you'd be better off to try to capture setback plantings.
So this spring, I'm just trying to go for low-hanging fruit. So maybe that's not low-hanging fruit.
No, that's more complicated.
So just interestingly, I have a request right there for a setback tree, which is one sweet.
Perfect. Yeah. Okay, so low-hanging fruit. So finishing South Street would be, finishing South Street, because we have a lot of underwire trees, would be like low-hanging fruit, so we can flip to the other side of South Street and try to finish that.
There's still, they identified six spots where large trees could, go, and then also swapping out the trees that we know were too small for their spot. And then if we want to do underwire, sure, we can do underwire.
So South Street and King Street?
I didn't say South Street and King Street. I said South Street and Route 10.
Right, but we just had a little trouble at the end of Route 10.
Well, sure. So that stop where the state highway starts.
Right.
But that still includes a lot of part of the city. Mm-hmm. It's Elm Street, Locust Street, North Main. You know, there's. I mean, according to the tree inventory, there's 20 some trees.
South Street and Route 10.
Yeah.
South Street's Route 10, and it goes all
Route
the way.
Route 9 and Route 10.
So South Street, Route 10.
Yeah.
So they're all the way out to the bridge, basically, except stopping before the bridge, because it's, well, we're doing a little part of
it. Well, all the way from Florence, say the Florence roundabout, or even really Leeds onward. Yeah, that's Route 9.
Route 9.
So I guess the question is that because of the amount of trees we have available to us, and the ones that we would like to purchase, we have to probably pick one or two locations to actually have a high, to actually do this planting. Reserve, like Marilyn said, a certain percentage of these trees that are large for those locations, another percent of the trees for setback plantings for folks that, you know, request them.
Okay, so I had selected on this search only vacant large sites. So if I do vacant all sites, small, medium, and large, and do the search, and then just focus on a part of Gateway, then we could be much more efficient and we would have more options, right? And I mean, there's just tons and tons of hits on the gateways. So, I mean, we could just narrow on, I don't know.
I like the idea of concentrating on South Street, because we did start that, we had some issues there. I think it would be nice to get that finished.
I'm fine with that. I agree with you. I think we should finish. We have the trees we have to swap out, and then we have to decide how we're going to deal with, you know, the underwire plantings and trying to position those properly and on the other side of South Street so it doesn't look so lopsided.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, it's going to look lopsided no matter what, because you're going to have large trees on one side, but at least you'll have, you know, a tree that's 25 to 30 feet tall that's going to provide shade, it's going to provide a screen for residents to walk on that side of the street. And there's a lot more folks that walk on that side of the street, everything back and forth, because of the just all the side streets.
The neighborhoods.
So, I mean, I think just thinking about doing that and finishing the plantings that we have from last year, plus doing setback plantings, seems to me like a big, a pretty big endeavor for one planting cycle.
One area I'd really like to focus on, just because I have climate justice on my mind, is that intersection between low income and lack of canopy cover. So perhaps part of our percentage of our tree planting can be with an intentional effort to plant in at least one of those areas that we've identified. Low income, lack of canopy cover.
Okay, so South Street?
So, I mean, South Street, yeah, I mean, if you look at it with all of the vacant spots, there's, you know, 50 trees there.
Yeah, so I really support what Rich just said, like focus on one gateway, South Street, right now. And then we have all the other things going, which are trees committed. For instance, we've already got a bunch of trees going in on Bridge and the, different, we've already got a bunch of.
We've got places we've already staked out and did stake last year that we were unable to get to.
Okay.
That we would like to finish, that we've got our holding nursery cleaned out. And then we obviously need to go, we have a whole bunch of work on South Street.
Okay.
You know.
And do you feel like you'd be able to get inventory appropriate for South Street?
South Street's relatively easy because it's a wide tree. It's relatively wide tree belt, so it can accept a relatively large.
But most of the sites are going to be under wires.
And we have a lot of under wires.
You have a lot of under, okay. All right.
Yeah, what's left of the nursery is most.
Yeah.
Is mainly under wire.
Yeah.
Smaller.
And is it all over the map? Because this goes back to the whole, are we going to try to have some, you know, aesthetic?
Right. So it'll be, there are four species. One of them is only 10, the other is at least 15 of the four species. So, well, it's actually not a species. There's two kinds of crab apples. There's American hornbeam and there's winter king hawthorn. But those can be, you know, we can have more. There's quite a lot of each of them. Uh-huh. So they can be laid out however.
Those are the only four underwater species we've got to work with?
Those are what we have left under our contract for Amherst.
Right. That's four species is, you know, you have to get them, I mean, they're in, if you don't want to have it sort of scattered, you need to have some kind of pattern.
Mm-hmm. It's not that I'm just not a huge crab apple fan.
Well, what would you prefer?
I love flowering cherry. If we're thinking flowering, because I think a gateway would be awesome to have flowering trees.
You like cherry.
I like cherry, dogwood. I don't know how these trees do as in terms of salt tolerance.
Yeah, I don't know. Off the top of my head,
yeah.
But dogwood doesn't strike me as necessarily.
Yeah, Jay, salt tolerant flowering trees?
I think we could add dogwoods in there. I don't know if any of them are any more salt tolerant than the others, but.
Mm-hmm. But do you have any favorites? Do you have any favorites?
Favorite dogwood?
No, favorite flowering, like understory flowering trees.
I think a combination of red bud. You got to change your colors up to some white crabs.
It'll be interesting to them in a block though. Yeah. They have three or four.
Yeah, I was just trying to think how you.
I think, and obviously we have to go to each site and kind of figure out, you know, how the wires are, where the poles are set, you know. Because it can vary, you know, they can swing around. I don't know. So, I mean, it would be interesting. So we have to really take those vacant sites to the other side and actually just kind of walk. We just got to walk down there and
Right, there's occasionally the wire veers or crosses, and you can put a bigger tree in.
Correct, so you could have three of one type, you could have one large tree or a medium-sized tree, and you could have three of another underwire flowering tree, so you could mix it. I mean, again, it's really about trying to match what we presently have available to us that we own already, to try to finish that project and make sure that it looks nice, you know. You don't want this and that, all kinds of.
Okay, so just to try to wrap this paper up, okay. Do we agree that we want to focus on South Street, completing South Street this spring?
Yes, as long as we're accepting of some apple prep apples.
Okay.
Yeah.
Other people?
I like the idea of focusing on an area that I feel like will be an easy way for us also to get some press around this, because it will be, I think, really much more visible than what they're doing on South Street.
Right, okay. Good, all right, I feel like we have consensus then, that we're gonna focus on completing South Street, both sides, this way. Okay. And then, so Rob, your job is that you're gonna go and confirm that the data in here is right, wrong, or whatever, you're gonna tighten it up.
Right, like, I go to each site and then list what size tree.
Okay.
And then Rich can look at that, because I measure I measure the tree belt, and I give the distance to the wires.
Yeah.
So, you know, I come back and say, I think a large tree from here, and here's the distance to the wires, and then Rich either thinks so or not.
Try and get an idea of spacing so like Rich said, so we can come up with some sort of pattern
for
planting.
Right, well that's, exactly, I usually bring stakes with me, and then that helps visually put it out, and then I leave the stakes there and send the listing.
And can I just throw this out there? Because there are very defined blocks all along South Street, can we try on that side of the street where it's underwire, can we try to each block have like a focused type of flowering tree?
I think that's what we're talking about.
Yeah,
yeah. Okay, so people like that idea?
Yeah.
Okay. And that...
It wouldn't be one, it'd be a pattern.
Right. Well, it could be whatever. It's true. That's true.
Yeah, well,
it could be
some plot to it.
Yeah, it could be. It could be every other on, you know, from Fort to Olive, and then it could be every other different types from Olive to whatever Revelle.
But are we limiting it to flowering trees?
The small ones, I think.
Well, I mean, there are other. I mean, what are we not putting them there?
I think we're looking at what we have and.
But I mean, we include ironwood
trees. Fit in and look nice as a group.
I mean, not every tree will necessarily be
flowering. Yeah, I don't necessarily need every tree to flower, but I do think that we have kind of a dearth of flowering trees on prominent streets in this town. So that would be kind of a neat dramatic change. Would be to have a street that actually flowers, like.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Stands out.
Yeah.
I agree. I think it's just a matter of trying to figure out what we have available to us and. You know, the other thing too is that we're also not limited to just what's available to us. We have enough money, I believe, to actually purchase other trees. So we could decide that we want to do, you know, a row of cherries between a particular block site, right?
Yeah.
And just plant those there, and then use the crab apples on another block site, and then get some coosa dogwoods from a block site. I mean, we're not talking about a lot of money. You know, you're talking about $150 to $180 a tree.
Yeah.
If we go the grow bag method.
What's the distance that we're talking about that stretches South Street?
Going as far as the.
It's about a mile from.
To where the bridge comes in.
From South Park Terrace to Dewey Court is about a mile.
Dewey Court.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And that's what we're talking about, Dewey Court.
You could even go a little past Dewey Court, because that piece of property that's actually on the corner is a city pocket park.
It's supposed to.
Although it's pretty, it's pretty well. Oh, yeah. That's
so. I'm always interested in starting is from downtown outward. Mm-hmm. If we don't reach the outer part, just because more people.
Yeah, I agree. With
walk
that.
On there.
Okay, so that could be part of our strategy.
Speaking of downtown, do we have any say whatsoever in? doing any planting around the, what they're doing around Pulaski Park. There's such a gap of trees there now. Like in the parking lot or...
What do you mean in the parking lot?
Well, they took down that whole wall of trees in the back of Pulaski Park and they're building the stairs and...
It's all, that has a planting plan?
Yeah, it has a...
It does, yeah.
It has a huge...
All contracted.
But yeah, it looks pretty grim right now, but it's gonna get better. Okay, so I'm just gonna summarize what I think we've agreed to. We've agreed that we're gonna focus on South Street. We've agreed that we are gonna have some kind of a patterned approach. We've agreed that Rob is gonna confirm the appropriate size of the trees. We've confirmed that we're gonna start from the downtown and move our way out. This is not something we've agreed to, but I would like to just throw this out there. I would love to get Jen's input, because I think that, you know, as a landscape person, she might have some thoughts about if we do have the ability to select additional flowering trees or what have you, I'd like to just get her input on that. Is everyone okay with that?
Mm-hmm.
And also she happens to be a resident of that neighborhood, so she's got some direct investment in it. Okay.
And this will be our spring planting.
Yeah.
Yeah, mostly. I mean, the thing is that some of the trees can only come in the fall. Mm-hmm. So we might just...
reserve some capital. Yeah.
You know, have to leave a stake for when they arrive in the fall.
Okay, good. Great.
Worthwhile.
Yeah. Okay. Have I missed anything? All right. Update, Tree Northampton.
Yeah. So, you know, without much detail, I can say that we haven't had very many meetings. There's someone in our group that is kind of key who is dealing with like issues that prevents us from having meetings, and I hope things get better. We did go out and prune some trees. That was using the skills that Jay, Rich helped us with the weekend before we went out. That seems to be ongoing, but slowly. So we haven't engaged too many of the people that took the training yet. I'm hoping that we'll get everybody out there that took the training. We have asked, I think Tree Northampton, not me, asked Rich if we could make these signs. Mm-hmm. And I don't know where that stands after the meeting with the mayor, but whether we can go ahead. Is that too confusing to have all three?
No, I don't think it was confusing. Lily had some recommend some word changing.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know,
yeah, so I passed that back to you.
I have that, so okay. I will forward that to Alicia.
Alicia. Right.
And CCU.
Because I think that as far as just getting people interested in...
Mm-hmm. Oh, I think it's huge.
I think it's
great.
Yeah.
We want that. I think that's our... I mean, aside from that, Tree Northampton folks are planning to do some table, including the arboretum, but also other ones. Their indoor market, I think they're going to, and the outdoor market is a bit difficult. They can't... There's no tabling space there or mm-hmm. something, but they're trying to figure it out. Yeah. They want to, and I'm not sure what they're doing. That's pretty much it. It is a problem that we are a bit stalled in like people's home life issues right now.
Uh-huh.
So hopefully that will improve.
Okay.
Rob, what's the, the core group of folks that, like you said, manage Tree Northampton?
Yeah, exactly.
You see any, is that growing at all?
No. And it's purposely not run, because I think everyone's trying to figure out how to manage what they're and define what they're doing. And so it's hard to bring people in there. It would be now, it turns out, good to have that, because we're kind of down a couple people due to various problems. It's been hard for us to assign work and hand out what to do, because people are just learning themselves. Remember, they haven't even been there a year yet, so. But I think that it's a good point that once people are more comfortable in their tasks, they should be bringing other people in, spreading the work around more, so we can keep moving. And I think it particularly applies to me. I had my hand in a lot of it, and I'm working my way out.
You get like me.
Well, I'm trying to get other people to do as many tasks, including with the tree, young tree training right now. I kind of feel an obligation to go out with each group, because I feel that I represent Tree Northampton. We're trying to make sure that it all goes smoothly, but I'm hoping that there'll be other people that can start going out without my being there.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, thank you for that. There was one more, I just want to circle right back to South Street one, because there's one more thing that I feel like we need to get in front of, and that is when, after Jay and I did that walk through and on South Street and identified the trees that we thought needed to be moved, we sent you a list. Mm-hmm. So at this point, if you agree with Jay's assessment, it was essentially Jay, then you can go ahead and start the paperwork for tree hearings on all those trees. Because it would be great if that was all done, and then we could, you know, move those with these. Okay.
Oh, and then I guess if I'm going to work on South Street, just send me a copy of which ones will be gone so that I can, as I'm trying to figure out what's coming, I can.
Good. I was gonna bum out Star Wars, no.
I know, it can't be done. It was almost possible to.
It was. We're doing great with 60 of us. So I was saying, it was 60 not too long ago.
Yeah, but because I think tree planting could start in a few weeks.
All right, and then I think we are ready to do our to-do list recap.
Alrighty. Lily's gonna send Jay the link for the MGL 87, which Jay's gonna look at and provide a summary for us at our next meeting. Lily's gonna meet with the mayor and also make connections with the East Hampton city planner and climate activist there, and make some connections to officially invite Rich to the meeting. Rob is going to the March 22nd hearing. You are going to do some investigation on iTree first beforehand. And also, Rich and Jay are going to the hearing. And again, that's at 137 Park Hill Road. I just put Rich is going to meet with Tree Northampton whenever that happens. It wasn't a date on there. I'm going to arrange for the tree whip distribution oversight of getting those slots filled. So that's 8 to 3 on Friday the 28th and 8 to noon on Saturday the 29th. Jay's going to help with planting on that Saturday, September 22nd at the high school. Lily's going to follow up with the Northampton High School Environmental Club. And Rich is going to send a note to the superintendent regarding planting at the school, as well as a possible tree planting on the 28th downtown. Lily, let's see, is gonna. Oh yeah. How do you do that? I have Rich checking on the roundabout area for tree planting over on Route 5. And Lily. Going to follow up with Jen regarding her landscape architect perspective on the South Street planting. Mm-hmm.
Good. In the center of the roundabout, is there any possibility?
Not low hanging fruit, huh?
Yeah, that would be.
That would be.
That'd
nice,
be
actually.
Very high.
That would be nice.
Go around,
go around,
that.
Go around the tree.
That would be awesome. But anyway. All right, we're trying to get out of here. I got to get out of here in like 3 minutes. So. Okay. Anything else?
That's it.
Okay, motion to adjourn this meeting?
I make a motion to adjourn this meeting.
Second.
Okay, all in favor?
Aye.
Meeting adjourned.